Hello friends, my name is Harshit Dwivedi, and in this video we are going to talk about, you know, the Member of Parliament in India, what are the qualification and eligibility of for becoming a Member of Parliament in India, and how the, you know, Member of Parliament in India are disqualified from being a Member of Parliament. I am going to say Member of Parliament as MP in this video. So first of all, for being an MP, we are going to look at the qualifications which are itself laid down in the Constitution of India. So the very first is, he must be a citizen of India. Second, he must make and subscribe to an oath or affirmation before the person authorized by the election commission for the purpose. Okay. When the MP takes an oath or affirmation, he swears to bear true faith and allegiance to the Constitution and to uphold the sovereignty and integrity of India. Then second condition is that for being a member of parliament, and that to be a member of a Rajya Sabha, the candidate should not be less than 30 years of age, and for being a member of the Lok Sabha, the candidate should not be less than 25 years of age, and whatever qualifications that are prescribed by the parliament, that particular candidate should have those qualifications with him. Now this point, that he must possess the qualification prescribed by the parliament. Okay. Parliament has enacted the Representation of People Act 1951. And these qualifications are listed in the Representation of People Act 1951 and not in the Constitution of India. So the very first qualification, which is, or eligibility, which is written there in the RPA Act of 1951, is that for being eligible to be a member of parliament in India, the candidate should be registered as a voter or elector in any parliamentary constituency of India. And this is applicable for both Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha. That is for contesting an election for a Rajya Sabha seat, then also he has to be a member of the parliamentary constituency, and for Lok Sabha, he also has to be a member of the parliamentary seat. Before 2003, there was a rule that for contesting for a Rajya Sabha seat, the candidate must be an elector in that particular state. But after 2003, this condition was waived off. Now, for being a candidate for a Rajya Sabha seat from a particular state, you don't need to be an elector in that particular state. For example, if you want to contest for a Rajya Sabha seat from UP, you don't need to be an elector in UP. You can be an elector in any other state also. This was happening when Manohar Parrikar was, you know, removed from the CM of Goa and he was made the defense minister. Then obviously he was chosen as a Rajya Sabha member from Uttar Pradesh. So you can see that for being a member of a Rajya Sabha, now you don't need to be an elector in the same state. And in 2006, Supreme Court has upheld the constitutional validity of this change. A member of the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes can, you know, contest for the seat which is reserved for him, and can also contest for a general seat which is not reserved for him. So scheduled caste and scheduled tribes can contest for all types of seats in the election. However, a general category candidate will not be able to contest on seats which are reserved for scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. On seats reserved for scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, only people of those respective communities are allowed to contest. Now we are going to talk about the disqualification conditions of the Member of Parliament as laid down in the Constitution of India. So the very first thing is that candidate should not hold any office of profit under the union or state government. Okay. But office of profit doesn't mean that it has to be a minister or any other office that is being exempted by the parliament. Now, one thing I would like to tell you about this office of profit, friends, that office of profit clause has been, you know, misused many times by the government, even by the union government and state governments. Why? Because, you know, there is a provision which says that if the central government or the state government exempts you from the definition of office of profit, then even while holding that office, you can be a member of parliament or member of legislative assembly. So office of profit is defined by the union or state government only. So the very first disqualification condition is that if he holds any office of profit under the union or state government, then obviously he can be disqualified. However, office or profit is itself divided by union or state government. So this condition has been severely misused many a times. If you want me to explain this office of profit thing in detail, please tell me through the comment section. I will make a separate video for it. It is a big topic. It cannot be, you know, computed within this thing. Second disqualification condition is that if the candidate is of unsound mind, or if he is declared as of unsound mind by a court, or obviously if he's an insolvent, that is something, some type of financial case or any other course is going against him, or that person is not a citizen of India, then he cannot compete, you know, then he is not qualified to be a member of the parliament. And for example, if he is a member of parliament and he has, being a member of parliament, voluntarily acquired the citizenship of a foreign state, or he is under the acknowledgement of allegiance to a foreign state, then he will be disqualified to be a member of parliament in India. Okay. Or if parliament makes any law, and if a member of parliament is disqualified under that particular law, then obviously he is also disqualified for being a member of parliament. Example in this case is the anti-defection law, 10th schedule. You know what happens to the anti-defection law? That if you vote against the party leadership lines or advices, you can be disqualified from being a member of the parliament. So this is one more disqualification condition. Also, these were the disqualification conditions which were written in the Constitution of India. Now, there is one condition: if he is so disqualified under any law made by the parliament. So any law made by the parliament, Representation of People Act 1951 has been made by the parliament. So there are some disqualification conditions who are given in the RPA Act 1951. Let's see what are them. If a member has been found to be guilty of certain election offences or corrupt practices in elections, then he can be disqualified to be a member of parliament or MP. Or if that member of parliament has been convicted for any offense which results in imprisonment of 2 or more years, then also, you know, he will be disqualified to be an MP. Convicted means that the crime is proven and the judgment of punishment has been given to that particular candidate. So if he is convicted for an offense which involves an imprisonment of 2 or more years, then he is, you know, barred from being a member of parliament for around for a particular time duration. However, the detail I will tell in the Supreme Court Lee Thomas case. For if a MP is under detention of a preventive detention law, then that is not a disqualification. Preventive detention law is preventive in nature, so it does not lead to a permanent disqualification. Also, a candidate should file his election expenses within the required time frame. If he has not filed his expenses in the required time frame, then he may be disqualified. The member of parliament should not be involved in government contracts, works and services. He should not be a director or managing agent in any corporation in which government has at least 25% ownership share. Okay, he should not be dismissed from government service for corruption or disloyalty to the state. Okay, he should not be convicted for promoting enmity between different groups. These may be communal groups, this may be religious groups, this may be caste groups. He should not be charged for bribery. He should not promote social crimes like dowry, sati, untouchability. All these things he should not do. Obviously, for example, if a question comes that if a member of parliament is subject to any of these disqualifications that I have told under RPA Act 1951, then the decision of the president will be final in this case. Okay. But the president, while giving this decision, should act according to the opinion or after consulting the opinion of the election commission. So election commission should be consulted before taking a disqualification decision against a tainted MP. You can say this. Okay. And this grounds of disqualification, I've already told you, member of parliament is also disqualified on the grounds of defection. That is the anti-defection law under the 10th schedule of the constitution. This I am going to take up in a separate video, as it is a big topic and cannot be covered in this thing. Now, there was a Lily Thomas case of 2013. What happened in this Lily Thomas case of 2013? This is important. Now, there was section 8.4, you can say section 8 and subsection 4 of the Representation of People Act 1951, which gave a respite or reprieve of 3 months of the legislator from immediate disqualification if they are convicted for an offense, so that they can file an appeal in the higher court. What happened, friends? So suppose a court, you know, convicts or charges a legislator for any charge and, you know, gives him a punishment of 3 years. So what that legislator used to do under this section 8.4 of the Representation of People Act 1951, that MP used to go to a higher court and file an appeal in the higher court within 3 months of the judgment of the previous court. And if he is able to file an appeal in the higher court, what will happen? That his disqualification will be stopped. So Supreme Court in the Lily Thomas case 2013, what it did, that in the Supreme Court judgment of 2005, Supreme Court said that differential treatment of legislatures and candidates can happen. That is, for example, candidates can be disqualified previously, but once a candidate has become an MP, then obviously MP, there will be some differential treatment of that MP. And Section 8(4) of Representation of People Act 1951 was said to be constitutional in that case. But Supreme Court in Lily Thomas case 2013, you know, declared Section 8(4) of the Representation of 1951 as unconstitutional and said that differential treatment of legislators and candidates violates the law of equality as envisaged under the fundamental right of Article 14. Okay, friends. So now, when suppose a legislator or MP is convicted by a court for say 3 years. So now he immediately is disqualified. He cannot go to a higher court within 3 months. What Section 8(4) of Representation Act 1951 said, that obviously a person, if a MP is able to file a appeal in a higher court within 3 months, then his disqualification will be stopped. But now Supreme Court in the Lily Thomas case 2013 has said that after interpreting Article 101 Clause 3 Subclause A, the disqualification, as soon as the judgment is given, is immediate. That is, the legislator cannot, you know, use Section 8(4) to stop his disqualification, and he will be immediately disqualified. So now Section 8(4) of the Representation of People Act 1951, this is unconstitutional law. Now obviously, if something like this will happen, then obviously Parliament is going to react, and Parliament reacted and passed an amendment to the Representation of People Act 1951 and tried to reinstate Section 8(4). Okay, and tried to provide a cooling off period of 90 days and also allowed the convicted legislator to continue if she is able to get a stay on either the sentence or conviction from a higher court. But obviously, when this, you know, this bill for negation of this Supreme Court judgment was introduced in the Raj Sabha, a furor was created. And you know, people were very much angry that there is a politician and criminal nexus, and everyone was against this hegemony of the member of parliament. That then Law Minister Mr. Kapil Sibal said that the negation of this clause is important, and Section 8(4) is very, very important because member of parliaments will become vulnerable. Because they can also be, you know, involved, they can also be charged for a false crime, which they may have not been committed. But obviously, the furor over this negation bill was so wide, that is, the bill which was being introduced in the Rajya Sabha to negate the Supreme Court Lily Thomas judgment was withdrawn due to very huge furor. Because people were very much angry, that people also wanted that now criminally involved member of parliament should not be in power, and now the bill was, you know, withdrawn. So now Section 8(4) of Representation of People Act 1951 is unconstitutional. So at the moment, any court charges a member of parliament for any crime of more than 2 years, immediately that member of parliament is disqualified from being a member of a parliament. Okay, friends, so this is the disqualification procedure and the eligibility position of the member of parliament. Friends, some things are remaining which I will cover in detail. That is, anti-defection law is remaining, and obviously the office of profit thing is remaining. That I will cover in a separate video, because that those things are a bit big and requires a whole lot of explanation. So I hope, friends, you have liked this video. If you have liked this video, please share your reviews with me in the comment section. Also, please subscribe to my channel if you like this video. And if you have any doubts, please ask me about those doubts in the comment section below. Thank you for watching this video, friends. Have a very, very nice day. Goodbye.